with St. Paul, the Fan.
The Upper Midwest's biggest boat sale is back. The Discover Boating Minneapolis Boat Show, in partnership with Progressive Insurance, is headed to the Minneapolis Convention Center January 18th through the 21st. Head over to our contest page, KFAN.com, keyword contest, for your shot at a pair, at a family four-pack of tickets, excuse me, KFAN.com, keyword contest, to enter.
Time for finding some way to get through my...
Kevin Seifert is back with us. It's the top of the 4 o'clock hour. Bradshaw and Brian, KFAN text line is 646-86. I don't know. You're kind of a pro football snob.
Yeah.
You tend to look down on the college game. So I don't know if you spent any time or had any time to watch the national championship game last night. But it was, I think for me, beyond the game itself, philosophically speaking, it was a good example of how challenging the evaluation process can be on a guy who has emerged at the quarterback position after starting at Indiana University, Michael Penix Jr. He has this incredible run in Washington, yeah. Stays healthy, leads the team to the national championship game, was absurd how accurate he was and how effective he was. And then in this game, second half, he's awful, downright awful. And so we go from the one extreme in the before that game of, that's guy Vikings got to get. You got to get him. Look at him. He throws a ball. He's a magician. He throws it everywhere. It gets out of his hand fast, or he can throw the deep pass, to he got exposed. It's over. We can't even consider him. So, and he's in that group, right? He's in the so-called second tier, at least at this point, I think, where you say, well, that's a guy the Vikings could get at 12 if they want, even though some people think he actually is more worthy of a little later in the first round. So you've been dealing with this for years, general managers and coaches. This is really where they make their money, right? It's figuring out what's actually right to overreact to about a bad performance and what is dangerous to overreact to because there are reasons why, perhaps, including the fact that the other team's really good and he didn't have much infrastructure around him when he needed it, in figuring out how does that game, that quarterback's game, project to the professional level?
Well, in my experience, if one game, whether it's a national championship game or the first game of the year, puts a team on either side of whether they want to draft him or not, that's a bad process. So I would say that for almost every team that's going to be looking for a quarterback, 98% of the evaluation will be based on something other than last night. It's a chance to measure your observations in the most stressful situation he'll ever be in, not only because of the championship game, because as you point out, Michigan's defense is pretty good as well. And Washington had some injuries around him that limited, I think, their offense, especially the running back, limited their offensive effectiveness, I think, last night. And so you'll definitely measure that, your priors against what you saw. But and publicly we can have fun with it and think like this is, talk about whether this means he's a first-round pick or a fifth-round pick. But in most every NFL building, I would imagine that a lot of the, I don't say the hay's in the barn already, because they do, a lot of the private workouts and they do a lot more medical stuff, especially in the coming months. I'd be really surprised if that game last night that he had would change the minds of anybody who's already down the road on evaluating him.
Lots more texts are coming in on not just this subject and several others, because I do want to talk about the defense before we're done. Let me ask a broader question. And this might be also a situation where I'm overreacting to the end of a season, and that also can be tricky because to a certain extent it's garbage time. You could look at the Bears, for example. Bears finished strong, but they weren't playing really for much of anything, had very little chance to make the postseason, had to have 25 things happen, and they weren't playing great teams much of the time because they were playing the last place schedule. There are people out there who believe that right now, if you're honest in your evaluation, the Vikings are the most vulnerable team in the NFC North, that all three other teams are either better or have a chance very quickly to get better than the Vikings. Do you agree or disagree?
Well, all three of them are ascending, you know, or at least we're ascending throughout a good portion of the season. And the end, you know, especially, I mean, whether it leads to the Packers, you know, making the playoffs and then losing in the first round or not, I don't know. But like the things that they're all three of those teams have done in the second half of the season give you not just because they were playing well, but the things that they have done in particular give you reason to think that they have a chance to start off next year pretty well. We saw the exact same thing with the Lions last year. I think they finished strong last year.
They did. And then started. And you doubted them.
And I doubted them. I said, let's see them do it in a situation where they're not already out of the playoffs. And they did. And there's a lot of reasons to think that the Packers, who are the youngest, younger than some high school teams, if you listen to people talk about them, they are very young, the NFL's youngest team. But that's a reason to think that they're ascending as well. And the Bears, you know, the Bears, I don't know, because if they start over a quarterback, then it's hard to believe that. But certainly some progress on defense and some if they keep Justin Fields, he's better now than he was when he started.
And they got the number one overall pick.
Yeah,
again, and then they have their own pick. I don't know what that is.
It's in the top 10
is it? Yeah, that's not a bad gig if you can get it. Texter guy writes to me, geez, Dan, based on the last two shows, it seems as if you want to unload Cousins, draft a QB, and focus on the run game. Is that true? So I have
run game
pounded hard on not the run game so much as the imbalance that I think does not serve the purpose of even this passing game and this head coach, in part inspired by some of the stats you had from a couple of weeks ago. So am I irrational on that subject? Do you think they ever are going to be willing to acknowledge that whether it's we don't have the horses to run or we're not committed enough to the run, we have to make the run game a bigger part of what we do, or we're asking for trouble, whether the quarterback is Cousins or somebody else, as it pertains then to more likely that you're going to still have a decent number of turnovers that you otherwise might not have, that it does matter. And to the great teams, that doesn't mean they're running half the time, but it does mean they're running more smartly, more efficiently in a way that if it's done right, actually can enhance JJ's situation, his status, the tight end situation and opportunities as well.
No, and I do. And I think internally there is a general understanding that they're not going to be, there's a low ceiling on how good they can be offensively if they're not able to run more effectively than they did this year. I do think there's that recognition from what I can hear and tell and see.
But they got to prove it.
Yeah,
they talked about it last offseason.
Yeah, and the attempts that they made, in some cases, were productive. I think Oliver is a good run blocker. It's just you can't change the entire face of your run game based on one tight end blocking
right.
who plays 20-30% of snaps. But I think you know whether they, whatever the reason is, they misfired on Madison. I think that. You know, to go into the season believing that he was going to be, could be, I mean, you look at the, you know, even if you want to move the ball in chunks through the air, you look at how things bogged down towards the goal line. I mean, he didn't have a rushing touchdown this year. And had a lot of goal line opportunities or goal to go, at least opportunities. Ty Chandler was a little better at that, but, that alone, even if you, like I said, even if you want to still be past first team, I think they very much saw like what it means when you get down near the goal line and you don't really have a strong running option.
When we come back, I want to concentrate a little bit more on the defense, what the future is for B-Flow, what the future is for our guy Hixie, Harrison Smith, and of course the Daniel Hunter contract situation as well. At the bottom of the hour, we'll get kind of a national view. Robert Smith, former Viking, who was, I think, had a lot of interesting things to say earlier today with your guy Bayless on Penix, for example, and the national championship game. We're trying to put a grand in somebody's hand again this hour. Is that correct?
Yes, we are. The Fan and the Big Ten Conference want to give you that shot at a grand in your hand at the National Cash Contest. Head to KFAN.com, enter the keyword cash. That is cash for your shot at that $1,000. KFAN.com, keyword cash.
By the way, Luigi Early, he's going to join at the top of the 5 o'clock hour with what they tell me is a very big...
on iHeartRadio.
The 2024 TIAA Big Ten Women's and Men's Basketball Tournaments are headed to Target Center March 6th through the 17th. You can head over our contest page, register for your chance to win a pair of tickets to either tournament. KFAN.com, keyword contest center.
Kevin Seifert, is Brian Flores a lock to return as defensive coordinator to the Minnesota Vikings? And if he is, should we be celebrating that? We love the improvements, but then again, the second, last few games, you could say, well, did some things get figured out in the chess match by smart coordinators? What do we think?
I'd fall short of lock just because while I haven't heard of any interview requests or that he's accepted, it doesn't mean that there aren't some going on behind the scenes. And so I would hedge just a little bit on lock, but I think it's a very good likelihood that he's coming back this year. And I think that's should be a really positive thing for the Vikings. I thought he, to me, innovated a defense that had never been run at the NFL, partly because he wanted to, and partly because that's what the personnel situation here needed. You could make an argument, and the very defensible, I think, is that once it was time to adjust off of what teams were figuring out, they just didn't have the personnel to be able to do that. That would have been changing back to a lot more man coverage and some other things that they just didn't have the horses to do. Or you could say, like, come on, like, don't be so, naive and to think that, like, that was the only option, that he's the smartest guy ever. But I think in the big picture, it was a big upgrade. It was had a big impact. If you look at that 2 month stretch, that 10 week stretch when they were 7-3, all their wins of the year, that was when their defense was rolling. They had as big of a part in it as any pass that Kirk Cousins threw or catch that Justin Jefferson made or Jordan Addison or anybody else. And so I really look forward to seeing what he would cook up in future years. And I think that's an overwhelmingly positive thing for the Vikings.
Is Harrison Smith going to come back? I know you felt he was pretty philosophical after the game. Some people interpreted that as, well, maybe this is him saying it's over. But on the other hand, it's a long season. It didn't end the way he wanted it to, obviously. And so people can start saying stuff that they don't necessarily even intend as a hint that this might be the end of the run. Lieber told me he's utterly convinced he's not retiring. But then the next question is he automatically back here?
On the first one, I don't know him as well as some of the other reporters have been covering the team for much longer. And kind of he has a very unique way of talking and, like, communicating. And he's not very sentimental. And he did get sentimental after the game. And so that made them take notice. And I totally get that. My experience just in the larger group of NFL players is that there are a lot of guys at the end of a season, whether it's you made the playoffs or not, who don't want to play can't imagine going through the process that they just went through again. And Harrison even said that, like, he's been nursing this shoulder injury, and he said, right now my shoulder really hurts. And, like, that's all he could think about. Totally get it. The most shining example is that as Favre, when he would get to the end of the off season and then finally decide, I've got the itch to play again, and it would take him that long to forget all the pain and everything that he went through during the course of the season. So that's how I took what he said. He ultimately said, I don't have a decision and I don't need to have one now. And when I need to have one, I will. Now, if he wants to play, everything that Brian Flores has said,
he's expensive, isn't he?
Not too much. He was going to be this year, and he took a pay cut. And my guess is if he would do that again, I don't know that for sure. But Flores, raved about him. O'Connell raved about him. I don't think that he's the playmaker he used to be, but that doesn't mean that they don't view we've talked about all the holes they have to fill. Like, that would be one less they have to fill.
Jordan Hicks. Where's that going?
I'm not sure. I look forward to asking that question tomorrow.
Tomorrow is the Chief Brain Wizards back-to-back?
Together. My understanding is it would be together. Kwesi Adofo-Mensah and Kevin O'Connell will speak to us tomorrow about off-season stuff. They love, for the same reason they liked having Harrison Smith, they liked having Jordan Hicks. Like, Brian Flores was able to identify a veteran in each level. Harrison Phillips, defensive line, sure. Jordan Hicks, linebacker, Harrison Smith and the DBs, to sort of make a lot of on-field calls, make a lot of on-field checks that gave some nuance and some depth to their defensive calls that they had. And so there was definitely that. Ivan Pace, you know, seemed like he came along pretty nicely. And if they don't bring Jordan Hicks back, that would be a possibility there to replace him. But as we saw this year, sometimes you need more than one guy.
Daniil is, of course, the big one. We've talked a little bit about that from time to time. Let's play it out this way. If the Vikings find a way to re-sign Daniil and bring back Cousins, literally, do we know then how much money they would have left on the cap to do with whatever else they wanted to do? Is that like $150? Is that like $2.3 million?
They could have not as much as they want, but they could have enough to do some stuff. It would just mean that like they really backloaded those contracts to an extent that, you know, you're going to be paying for them for a long, long, long time. And so, and then you pile a Justin Jefferson extension on top of that, and then you really have some salary cap management going on there. And so I've always said you can do all the things, you can do most of the things you want as long as you're willing to sacrifice in the things that aren't the highest priority to you. And so I couldn't rule it out. You know, I don't know if that's great cap management, but, you know, certainly it would be a possibility. I just think Daniil's going to get to the market almost certainly. And
it's going to be big.
A 29-year-old guy coming off 16.5 sacks off of a 10-sack season the year before, like, you know, those kind of guys don't get on the market very often. And so, you know, I think Nick Bosa is the highest paid pass rusher. He didn't even get to the market. That's what he got was to keep him from getting to the market. Daniil's a little older and has the injury history, but man, like, I guess, like, other than a quarterback being on, you know, really, you know, quarterback in his prime being in the open market, a pass rusher in their prime being on the open market, seems to me like the sky's the limit. We'll see.
Let's finish with Justin Jefferson and whether you think this is the offseason where there absolutely will be, that you're convinced there will be a contract that will be, you know, satisfactory to both sides. Explain again what the Vikings' obligations are, because he's still under contract, right, for next year.
Yep.
But whether we're closer to that point where you can't go into this next season playing it out the same way we did this season. What do you think?
I mean, they certainly could, but to me, what you can't get into is franchise, getting to a situation where your only option is to franchise tag him, because that, like, that never ends well. And you saw how it ended with Kirk Cousins in Washington. So to me, that's one further year back. So this would be the last time to get him signed before you even have to consider franchise tagging him. Maybe that's the hammer that has to be held over both sides to get a deal done. I don't know. And that would be in the spring of 2025. And, you know, whether, you know, he's going to get a raise from $3 million or $2.5 million to $19 million this year based on his fifth year contract. But that's still like way out of the range of top end receivers. And, you know, I don't think that he has any extra urgency based on the injury he suffered. And so I think he once again put it in the Vikings court when he talked to us last. And so this would be the last year they could get it done. And probably, I'm sure everyone wants to get it done to where they don't have that ugliness of the tag hanging over them. But maybe in the end, that'll be the thing that that gets a deal done or separates them, you know, permanently is the threat of the franchise tag.
Do you believe ultimately the decision on Cousins will dictate how willing Jefferson is to lock in long term?
No.
Why not?
I think he is looking for a contract that in Cousins' words, where that represents the value that he thinks he has. And there's not an agreement yet on what that value is. And so, they're going to have, they're going to have somebody playing quarterback, and he's very smartly not said it has to be Cousins. He said, I think the word he used, if it is Cousins, it would be a perfect scenario for him, but he is not said it, and I don't think he's pushing behind the scenes that it has to be Kirk himself.
Seifert, brought to you by All Season Shane Company. We appreciate their support. We're not done with you yet this year.
Okay.
Is that okay?
Sure.
I mean, I don't mean like every week necessarily, but there's still There's always going to be Viking stuff to discuss, and there might even be some NFL playoff stuff to discuss.
It's a year-round sport. There's just not games every week.
That's it. That's exactly it. Thanks for coming in, as always, my friend. Appreciate
you. Okay, Dan.
You.
Thank you.
Kevin Seifert, ESPN.com. What does Robert Smith think about the national championship game last night, and what impact does he think he might have on the Vikings and other teams' interests in Michael Penix? He had some interesting things to say about the Washington quarterback earlier today.
KFAN, the fan.
The world's toughest cowboys return to downtown St. Paul February 2nd and 3rd for the world's toughest rodeo. See them at the XL Energy Center to catch all the action and excitement as they battle it out to be crowned Pro Rodeo's world champion. Tickets on sale now. KFAN.com. Keyword calendar.
And Lou Nanny will join at 5 o'clock. We're out at 6 today. Timberwolves back in action on the road, I believe, in Orlando. Game will not only be on the Timberwolves app via the iHeart radio app, I should say, the Timberwolves channel, but also will be on FM 100.3 The Fan. Robert Smith is with us now via the Connecticut Water Systems hotline, and we welcome you back to the program. It seems like you've been had some busy travels lately. You're always, though, busy, are you not?
I don't know about always busy, but it was a good busy. Excellent. The last few weeks with the games that we had. And we had Patriots and Jets this past weekend. Ooh. And, for all of the preparation, and, you see him in the press conferences with Bill Belichick. I mean, he was great with us. Now, full disclosure, my football agent represents him as well.
Yeah.
And, maybe Neil called him up and said, hey, be nice to him. But, he was, beyond pleasant. It was, I could have talked to him for hours because, all the things with his father in the Navy.
Sure.
And,
yeah.
Just his love of history, just separate from football. But the most revealing part of the conversation that would, I'm sure, interest you, and I want to hear your guess on this, what do you think his first concert was if his father made him go and it was on the naval base?
His first concert? Oh, my God, that's
a great
question.
And I can't say, actually, I can't say that it was on the naval base, but just think, like, he didn't say his exact age.
Yeah.
But I'm guessing, he's probably, 12 or 13 at this time. But he said it was a concert that your parents would want you to go to. So this must be 62, 63-ish.
62, 63-ish. Oh, my God. Well, it can't be the Beatles. Because I don't think they did anything on a boat that I'm aware of.
Okay. Well, I take that back about the naval base. I should have said naval base. And I'll just tell you.
All right.
It was the Letterman.
The Letterman.
But then also Tommy James and the Shondells.
Yeah.
But the best one was the first concert that he chose to go to, which would blow your mind. Iron Butterfly.
Iron Butterfly, that's tremendous. Oh, God. Well, the truth is, on Belly, when he's in the mood, he can be a good interview, and he does have a sense of history. He's shown that on a couple of documentaries as well. I just would think it has to be such an odd position. You're debriefing with a guy who apparently, is a lame duck. I mean, one of the greatest coaching performances ever. I guess further proof that nobody is bulletproof, man, but it's just so bizarre to think of that guy, and you're talking to a guy who, seems to have about as much, job security as the worst coach ever, even though he's been one of the best. It's just the way it works, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it's the nature of the business, but, you buy the ticket, you take the ride, and I think he knows that as well as anybody, and he understands that, like poker. You can go in with aces and lose, and you can screw things up a number of different ways. The NFL is just so different because, unlike baseball, there is a salary floor, right? Mm-hmm. With baseball, no salary cap, but there isn't a salary floor, so teams can just tank.
Mm-hmm.
In the NFL, everybody has a chance, and I think that's the most impressive part about what Bill Belichick has done over those 20 years, and obviously Tom Brady was a big part of that success, but. In the age of salary cap and free agency, just being able to hang on to a team and hang on to coaches, the carousel of coaches, carousel of players at a lot of different positions, it's impressive, to have six Super Bowls and whatever it was, eight or nine tries.
National championship game is a good place for us to start. That was, of course, last night. And there even might be some Vikings tentacles to it as well, which I'll get to with you in a minute. But regarding the result itself, how surprised were you with the way Michigan took over that game in the second half?
They took it over in the first half.
That's true.
Really,
yeah, you're right.
With the runs that they had early. I mean, they had three runs that accounted for 150 yards. And that, you know, kind of going into the game, the narrative was true about Washington. They weren't very good defensively, I think, in the 90s in total defense. And they would have been the lowest ranked defense to win a national championship in what started the BCS era in 98. So, you know, you have a defense like that, you can't afford to miss any opportunities offensively. And Michigan came in with the plan that they wanted and executed it perfectly. You have a big physical offensive line. You got great running backs. You run the ball down their throat. You get some play-action passes. And then in the second half, you can afford to not make any third downs. I think they were, I think they converted one third down.
Yeah.
Out of 14 or 15, you can afford to do that if the other team is missing open receivers. And I know that the conversation is going to end up on Penix and will he end up in Minnesota. But he missed some opportunities. And I'm not saying it's easy, but he certainly missed some opportunities. And I would think whatever his draft status was going into that game, the game hurt it. Now, the realities of what happened, was he injured, the pressure that he faced in the game, all those kind of variables, I don't know if he recovers from that and gets back to where people thought he was going to be, but we'll find out.
Yeah, I want to go there because, you know, I think the smartest evaluators look beyond any one game. They use all of it as tools, and maybe the game is symptomatic of a concern that, you know, a talent scout might have about how a quarterback's game translates. But I am curious to get your view, given he is a guy who's going to be available, it appears, when the Vikings pick. And there's this ongoing discussion about what the Vikings should do at the position. Did you have a general opinion about what you thought Penix is capable of being as a pro quarterback?
Did I have going into the game?
Oh, going in or even out, I guess, obviously, but just in general, watching him over the course of the time he's gotten since he got to Washington.
Yeah, well, I mean, to me, I would be concerned because of a game like that, you know, kind of what revealed itself. Again, I don't know the other variables.
Right.
You know, was he injured, different things like that. But just what I saw in that game from a footwork perspective, from an inconsistency perspective that is caused by footwork or rushing throws or incomplete mechanics throwing the ball, that was concerning to me. You know, especially if you're Minnesota picking at 11. Now, you know, you're comparing to some of the other guys, you know, that may be available, whether it's Caleb Williams or Drake May or Jaden Daniels. I would be more comfortable with what I've seen from those guys.
Right.
You know, but do you reach to grab a guy like that at 11? I mean, not from what I saw there. Now, I haven't broken down all of the film, and again, I don't know any of those other variables that might have contributed to what we saw, but I would be concerned.
Let me ask you a follow-up about the and you can address this because you played. I didn't. And I noted early in the show that, look, the kid has been unbelievable. It's a great run. He went to my alma mater, Indiana, looked great for a while, then got hurt, then looked awful. He finds a second life, and it couldn't have gone any better than it did at Washington. So I get all that. But as the game's playing out, and it's clear he's gotten he's got either sore ribs or he's gotten hit hard in the side there, and he's got some protection there, but he literally, Robert, to me, spent most of the last quarter and a half doing nothing but making it clear, seemingly wanted to remind people that I'm hurt. And it started to bug me. And then I felt guilty for being bugged by it. I said, well, I've never gotten hit like that. Who the hell am I to say? But you're a player, so you could speak to that.
Yeah.
Is there any body language issue there that should be concerning, or am I making it up as I go along?
A little bit of both, maybe. That's the great thing about the draft, right?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's reading the same information and watching the same film and interpreting it different ways, right? And that's everybody's right to say, well, he shouldn't have done this, he shouldn't have done that, he shouldn't have, you know, showed that body language. You know, generally speaking, never let him see you sweat,
right?
Especially at the quarterback position.
That's what I thought.
But, you know, who knows? Like, in today's age where everybody is so hyper aware of the cameras that are on them and the narratives that develop, you know, maybe that psychologically, like, maybe he couldn't resist the opportunities after those throws to let people know that he was hurt. So, you know, should he have done it? I don't know.
The big debate really is, and it's all connected, really, to having a high. This is the highest the Vikings have drafted in a while. And so because you look at the quarterbacks and say, well, maybe there is one that they like enough that you take at 12. Maybe not him, but maybe one of the other ones. Or maybe you're high enough that you actually can move up even more in a way that it's kind of hard to do if you're in the 20s or 30s. We're trying to figure out, all right, what you do. For a lot of people, it's either or. It's if you're going to bring Cousins back, don't take a quarterback that high unless you love one and then deal with other issues. Right. But if you do love one and you even move up to get one of those, maybe including Drake May or whoever else you name, the USC kid, then I think there's a feeling of, all right, let's just cut the cord. It's not a rip on Kirk, but it's time. It's time. Hand the keys to that guy, save all that money, spend it on a number of other glaring needs that you have. So where are you on how far the Vikings should go in order to ensure that Kirk Cousins comes back?
Man, that's a really good question. And, you know, I can give you like a really long answer that probably doesn't really go anywhere. Because, you know, honestly, like there are just so many variables that, and you just mentioned most of them, right? You've been doing your job well. Like you look at Kirk, but you look at his salary and the different ways that you can cover money up or spread money out with an older quarterback. And even if you do have a younger quarterback, you know, the amount of money that you have to spend, even at 11 or 12, just isn't that much compared to what you would have to spend on the open market to get a quarterback in. Now, the narrative that I'm hearing is that no matter what you do with Kirk Cousins, that you need to sign that quarterback in the first round. You know, is that the case? I just don't know. I don't know how much those guys value those quarterbacks that, you know, are likely to be three of the top four, if not three of the top five, or excuse me, three of the top five, if not three of the top four, maybe even the top three consecutive picks, because I think all three of those guys are going to be highly coveted. And teams generally overreach for quarterbacks, especially in the first round. So should they do it? I would be foolish to say definitively that I know that they should or shouldn't, because I don't know how those other pieces fit in. Are they going to spend the money to bring Danielle Hunter back? You know, are they going to spend money to sign Kirk? You know, is Justin Jefferson is his contract extension contingent on just Kirk coming back or liking the guy that they think they're going to be able to move up to? There are just too many moving pieces, but you know what? That's what kind of makes it fun.
Yeah.
And I know that everybody's kind of beat up from the season, but the season was kind of house money anyway. I think based on what they had kind of gotten rid of and where the team was, it felt like a growing year. And, you know, I think it ended up better, at least from that stretch, right? At that five-game winning streak where I think they were 1-5 going into that winning streak. Like, it seemed like it was a house money kind of season, and then Kirk gets injured, and, you know, everybody is crushed. But if you went into the season and you said, okay, well, Kirk Cousins isn't going to be, you know, in there, and, you know, this and that are going to go wrong at the beginning of the season, you would have never thought that by the end of the season you would have had even a chance to make it into the playoffs. So I think, you know, not making excuses for the organization, but I think they did pretty well under the circumstances.
Well, the key to this for me is what you said. I would be ready to pull the plug and say, thank you, Kirk. we're not mad at you, but it's just, it's time. If you're honest with yourself that you can get in round one, either by moving up or staying where you are, a quarterback that you think you can hand the keys to pretty quick, okay? But if you don't, that's the danger. You can't lie to yourself, because if you lie to yourself, that's where you get yourself in trouble. That's what this team did with Christian Ponder. They talked themselves into, you know what, sooner or later, we got to get a guy we can invest in and grow with. And by God, we're convinced that that Christian Ponder can be that guy. I think we determined he went 12th in that particular draft for Spielman. And it I don't say destroyed the organization, but it set them back. So to me, that's what this comes down to. If you don't love what you see there, and you're only interested in getting maybe later a third or fourth tier quarterback, to me, that's more reason to try to work with Kirk for two more years and sort of put this thing off. If you think, no, we love, there's five quarterbacks we actually like a lot, then to me, picking as high as you are, you got to do it, because you don't know when you're going to be picking this high again.
Oh, man. I mean, that's what this is fun though, man.
Yeah.
Like I really don't know the answer, but you know, even if you love one of those top three guys, what you don't know is how much any other teams love those three guys and what they're going to be. And first of all, let me start there. I think that it's going to be those top three, and then, you know, if it's Michael Penix or, you know, somebody else,
Bo Nix,
those guys are going to be in the next tier.
Yes.
Right, Bo Nix, they're in the next tier.
Correct.
Those guys, I think, could easily drop out of and probably will drop out of the top 10.
Yep.
But you don't know what other teams are going to be willing to spend.
That's,
you know,
true.
These deals can happen at any time.
Great point.
And you may not have the time to figure that out. And if you go ahead and make that decision and say, okay, well, we're going to let Kirk go, then that really triggers,
yep,
the next set of decisions, which is, now we don't really have you know, any more money that we can guess that we're going to need to allocate for this. We're going to have to go all in on this move. We're going to have to go all in, and, yep, we're going to have to give up a ton, potentially. Well, definitely.
Sure.
You're going to have to move up a ton, because everybody wants a quarterback.
Correct.
And everybody thinks that, you know, the new guy is going to be the answer. And that's why people overspend so much on first round quarterbacks, especially in that top 10.
No,
but there's no guarantee, right?
No.
I mean,
no,
we had last week.
Yep.
We had the Patriots and the Jets last week. I mean, and the Jets have done it twice, you know, over the last 6 or 7 years.
Yeah.
You know, with Sam Darnold, and then with Zach Wilson. you know, those are guys, top three,
yeah,
quarterbacks,
yeah,
that they selected, and neither one has worked out.
It's a great point. It's why, what makes the whole damn thing so difficult. Great to catch up. We appreciate the time. I got a lot more to get to you. We'll try to get to you the next few weeks, because the playoffs are still going on even without the Vikings.
Okay, one more thing.
Yes.
And you're going to love this one. I just started looking this up because I was looking up some first albums.
Yeah.
This, and I tweeted this. Even, I don't know if we're supposed to say tweet anymore since it's now X, but anyway, I X'd it out. 1967.
Okay.
The debut albums in 1967. If any of your listeners can find a more impactful year for any genre of music, let alone rock and roll music, how about this? So, David Bowie,
mm-hmm,
Pink Floyd, The Doors, Jimi Hendrix, Isaac Hayes, yeah, and Al Green. All debut albums in 1967.
I saw that tweet. And I may have even retweeted it. I don't know, but I, you're speaking to the choir there, man. That is stunning. That's some talent. That's some depth of talent right there that you just named.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah.
I'd love to hear another year.
Top that.
That was bigger.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we may get some texts on it, but it'll be pretty difficult to challenge that.
And Belichick said that he had an opportunity to go to Woodstock and he didn't.
Really?
And he said he's glad that he didn't. And I didn't want to say, well, coach, why? You know, you know, maybe it was a hippie thing.
Yeah.
A drug thing. I don't know what it was, but like, damn,
I hadn't heard that nugget. That's because most people will lie and they won't acknowledge that they went when they didn't. In his case, he's saying, I could have, and I didn't, which is a pretty honest answer by Belichick. That's outstanding. We'll definitely be in touch again. Thanks, man.
All right, talk to you.
Robert Smith, great stuff as always from him. Fox NFL analyst, obviously, pro football and college football as well, and there is a lot more to get to with him. We'll try to get him on maybe a little later into the playoff season, and maybe there'll be some new Vikings developments as well. Don't forget, we're out at 6 o'clock today. Luigi joins us pretty much every Tuesday. He's going to join a little earlier than usual. In fact, he's going to join us at the top of the hour, and he's got a big announcement that we're going to kick off our conversation with him with. That is coming.